Salutations, Celestial Sightseers. I'm David Fuller. Welcome to the fourth year of Eyes on the Sky. What's up this week? Let's look at Gemini. Jupiter is here and reaches opposition January 5th, which means we've got ourselves a syzygy! Anyway, the practical side of opposition means that the planet rises at sunset and goes below the horizon at sunrise, so it's pretty much visible all night long. Check out the orange equatorial bands, the cream-colored shading between them, and look for the red spot at 200 times magnification or more. Check out this page at Eyes on the Sky for more information on viewing Jupiter and other planets successfully. But that's not all. Gemini represents twins. After Jupiter, the next brightest objects here are the seemingly twin stars, Castor and Pollux. But they are far from actual twins. In fact, they're quite different. Let's stand Gemini up as it would appear in the west in early morning. Then we'll start with Pollux, the brighter of the two stars. This is a K-class orange star that is twice the mass of our Sun and almost nine times the radius. In 2006, it was confirmed as having a planet almost 2.5 times the mass of Jupiter, orbiting it every 590 days. Now, one could be forgiven for asking, twins? Really? When confronted with a comparison of Pollux to Castor. More on that in a moment. And now this week's Dark Sky Fact. Reduced or eliminated your own light pollution? Why not measure what still exists? The Loss of Night is a free Android app, and you can become a citizen scientist by quickly measuring light pollution in your area. And iPhone users, check out Dark Sky Meter, that is specifically designed to work with the camera on your phone. Compared to Pollux, Castor is a very white-looking A-class star. Well, I should say stars, because this is a multiple star system. Actually, a total of six stars. Though the ones we're looking at are the two sets of spectroscopic binaries that we can only split into two components, about 3 arc seconds apart. That's pretty close. The two brightest ones are also around twice the Sun's mass, but aren't as large as the orange Pollux. So the Castor components are quite luminous, given that they are 1.5 times as far away. They certainly are a lot hotter at 10,300 and 8,800 Kelvin, compared to the much cooler Pollux at just 4,700 Kelvin. Now, draw a straight line from Pollux, past Jupiter, towards Betelgeuse, but stopping about 15 degrees short of it. The star here is Alina, and it is as bright as Castor at magnitude 1.9. Turn 90 degrees, somewhat in the direction of Capella in Auriga, and locate Mu Geminorum, about one full finderscope field away, the fourth brightest star in the constellation. A cool red giant at 230 light-years distance will use this star to hop to a very large open cluster. 2 degrees away from there, towards Aldebaran, is another red giant star, Eta Geminorum, a super tight double that are just 1 arc second apart. But at 8th magnitude, this secondary is extremely difficult to split even with a large amateur telescope. Another 2 degrees away, parallel to our original Alina to Mu line, is Messier 35. This is a very large open cluster, about the size of the full moon, so use a long focal length eyepiece, as it can be easy to miss due to being spread out over such a large area. And check Eyes on the Sky too. I'll have more info on viewing objects discussed in this video, plus the Quadrantids meteor shower that occurs on Friday of this week. Try and spot a super young, thin crescent moon about a binocular field above Venus on the evening of January 2nd. Venus is dropping quickly in the evening sky, and we lose it as an evening star after this week. Poking above the horizon at midnight, but better seen 2 hours later, is Mars, which at 7 arc seconds across is worth starting to observe again. Look for it this week, forming a right triangle with Spica and Arcturus. Saturn trails behind Mars by 3 hours. Early risers can get a look at the ringed planet before morning twilight. That's all for this week. Keep your eyes on the sky and your outdoor lights aimed down, so we can all see what's up. I'm David Fuller, wishing you clear and dark skies.